Thanks, John. Good morning. Well, a beautiful, clear day coming up at least. Westerly winds, they've come at last. We still have plenty of waves around for the board riders. That swell's still fairly big. Still a slight tendency towards the northeast. Waves up around 2 metres at all of the open beaches. The lines of swell very long, hitting the banks on most of our open beaches at least, and closing out. No good rideable waves for the board riders as yet. With these westerly winds, conditions are going to improve. If these winds will stay with us all day at least, we're bound to have some good waves by this afternoon, especially on the northern corners, the northern protected corners of any of our city beaches at all. If you'd like to go and catch some waves, you'll have to be a bit keen. You'd also have to be experienced, and it's the northern protected corners. If you'd like to go for a swim, take extreme care. All of our city beaches are quite dangerous. And now our forecast, a cool to cold day with a few brief showers. Some sunny breaks through the day, west to southwesterly winds at 30 to 40 kilometres per hour and gusty at times. Slight to moderate seas on a moderate swell. Newcastle expecting a top today of 18 degrees, up in the valley at Scone a top of 16. And the outlook for Thursday, cool, dry, with moderate southwesterly winds. And that's the story for this morning. Offshore winds at long last, waves up around 2 metres plus at all of the open beaches in town. Unfortunately, a lot of closeouts for the board riders. If you're keen, a little bit of travelling would find some good waves. And also look for those northern protected corners where there are bound to be some nice long left-hand waves. Weather-wise, a fine sunny day coming up, a top of 18 degrees for Newcastle. Have a great day whatever you're doing. We'll be back again tomorrow morning.
When the Newcastle Cycleways movement was launched 6 years ago, the concept of cycleways seemed remote. But with the support of Newcastle City Council and the state government, the enthusiasm of the cycle group won through, and today a 6 kilometre cycleway running east from Jesmond has been completed. The overall plan calls for more than 90 kilometres of similar pathways and a number of improvements to the existing roadway. But the first stage cost the council and the government $350,000, so progress is naturally slow. However, Newcastle has received a lion's share of government funds set aside for cycle projects, and the area will also be used to monitor a 6-month test of a new enforcement procedure. Funded by the Department of Transport, Constable Tony Tamplin will patrol streets on a specially equipped motorcycle, handing out on-the-spot warnings to dangerous cyclists. A copy of the warning also being posted to the parents of young offenders. Education of young cyclists is being stepped up, aided by a new series of booklets which have the added appeal of Spike Milligan's unique brand of humour. Added emphasis on cycle safety has been prompted by increasing accidents.
Coming together for the first 14 time
cyclists
along the new
have died on New South Wales
route.
Roads this
the
year.
Launching took place at Market Square in the Hutter Street Mall, where a soup kitchen was set up for the day. Special guests for the occasion included actor Leonard Teal, MLA Don Bowman, who officially inaugurated the fast, and the Bishop of Newcastle, the Right Reverend Alfred Holland, along with media personalities. The aim of this year's 40-hour fast is to raise funds for third world community development, with special emphasis on Ethiopia. It's hoped $4.25 million will be raised nationally. As a starter, you could buy for a dollar a soup and bread lunch. Leonard Teal had some carefully chosen words to illustrate the needs of the hungry.
By this worthwhile gesture, show you care. By joining in the effort which we share, we ask you, please, today make your decision to help sustain the hungry through world vision. It's not...
Good afternoon. Well, fishing hasn't been really good outside the last week. The seas have been bad, to say the least. And most of the fishing's been done in the estuary. There's been very good catches of blackfish and big brim in Swansea Channel. And further up into the lake areas itself, I'd suggest probably around Spears Point area, Cockle Creek, where it runs out, places like that, especially with the rain and the fresh runoff we've had, you should get good catches of brim and the occasional jewfish, I would suggest. For the dewies, try and use live bait. They tend to go for that more. This weekend, I'd suggest probably tomorrow morning you'll get out for fish if you wanted to. I wouldn't go too far out. The wind waves out wide, that's out of the lee of the land itself with this offshore wind, would be pretty bad and very, very uncomfortable, I would suggest. But rock fishing would be generally okay tomorrow morning. Just keep an eye open for the very big wave. I don't think you'll get much of a swell, but you could get a bit of a bounce in close to the rocks itself. Drummer fishing would be the go, black fishing, and if you're keen enough, probably the occasional brim tonight, maybe. I wouldn't be venturing out too far if I was going outside in the morning. Just fishing the close reefs and close areas, very, very close to the headlands itself. That's about it. Good afternoon.
Meanwhile, an air and sea search again failed today to find a Canadian who fell from his yacht off the central coast at the weekend. The Newcastle police launch Doyle returned to base this afternoon, having spent the day in search with another police launch from Sydney and at least two helicopters. The search, which extended down to the entrance, failed to find a trace of 37-year-old John Whipple.
If we knew exactly where the man went missing from, you could conduct a pattern search from there, but there are no currents out there today, or no visible current lines. They're very calm, actually.
Senior Constable, you've obviously had a lot of experience in this sort of search work. Personally, do you think there's little hope?
Very little hope, I would say.
Still moored at Newcastle Police Wharf today was the small Ketch roving tar from which Mr. Whipple apparently fell on Sunday evening while adjusting self-steering gear mounted on the stern. It was towed into port by police launch on Monday afternoon after it was located about 10 kilometres east of Newcastle. Mrs. McBride of Lemon Tree Passage, accompanying Mr. Whipple on their intended trip from Port Stephens to Sydney, was unable to turn the yacht around after Mr. Whipple had gone overboard. A decision will be made early tomorrow if the search will be continued.
Since its opening in 1977, weekly participation in the Maitland SIS has grown from 25 to more than 100. The increasing numbers have stretched facilities to breaking point, so much so they are moving from their high street premises to a rented cottage in Church Street. One of the problems with the old centre was its second floor location, which prevented handicapped people from attending. Activities as diverse as photography, carpentry and secretarial studies have had to share the same two crowded rooms. Nevertheless, the young people flock there. It is a social meeting spot and a place to find guidance and help. Now they will spend time in three ground floor rooms in Church Street. A rear shed will allow more space for ceramics and bricklaying classes and will allow a motor mechanics course to be added to the program.
Erosion along Jimmy's Beach at Tea Gardens has presented a problem for the Great Lakes Shire for some time. It has applied for urgent government funding. Yesterday, the council was advised by the state government that it would grant $25,000 on a dollar-for-dollar basis for immediate beach nourishment, meaning sand replacement. But this does not solve the problem, and it's not what the council originally wanted. The council believes a study should be carried out to determine the best ways of treating erosion. That money is not forthcoming. So while Jimmy's Beach is to undergo urgent restoration work, the problem of further erosion still exists. The crest was presented to Mr. Wilson last night in the council chambers by the Lord Mayor, Alderman Joy Cummings. Mr. Wilson was clearly touched by the presentation, although the former Newcastle Rugby League chief did make his official vote of thanks with his tongue planted firmly in his cheek.
When my wife handed me that important envelope last week, I thought, gee whiz, I'm going to appear before a royal commission. However, the contents of that correspondence was quite good. And tonight I'm most humble and grateful for the honour that you good people have conferred upon me.
Mo Wilson has been involved in sport in Newcastle since his youth, when he played A-grade cricket, union and league. He became involved in the administrative side of things in 1934, when he was appointed to the committee of the Eastern Suburbs Rugby League. He is a life member of numerous sporting associations, but most people will probably remember him as president of the Newcastle Rugby League, a post which he held from 1960 up until last November.
Once again, thank you very much for your kindness and your thoughtfulness.
Cycleways development is already underway in the Newcastle City Council area, and the cycleways movement was hoping to get some started in Lake Macquarie. Now their Newcastle area bike plan looks like being limited to the city, at least for the time being. The Lake Macquarie Council says it supports the bike plan in principle, but at this stage does not have the funds to finance it in the lake area.
They have indicated their support and the fact that they will implement it. But at this stage, it doesn't appear as if funds will be available to match state government grants, which would be available in the next New South Wales state government budget.
Do you think, bearing in mind that the project has had a start in the Newcastle council area, that the people of Lake Macquarie are missing out a little bit?
The people of Lake Macquarie will miss out if this council doesn't support the engineering component of the bike plan, in particular the routes which join the two municipalities.
How will that affect the overall plan?
The safety benefits of the Newcastle area bike plan are dependent upon the behavioural studies as well as the on-road improvements. Without the on-road improvements in this municipality, the full safety benefits won't become apparent.
After a lengthy debate last night, the Lake Council voted to serve notice on both Caltex and on the proprietor of the Charlestown service station, Mr. Dennis Smith. Other service stations in the municipality carrying out illegal activities are to be sent a letter of warning. The Council claims that many of the activities carried out by the Charlestown Caltex are not in keeping with the definition of a service station laid down in the Environmental Planning and Assessment Act of 1979. The Act describes a service station as a place for the fueling of motor vehicles. They are, however, permitted to sell and install spare parts and accessories and wash, grease and repair vehicles. The sale of groceries, drinks and confectionery and the hire of cars, trailers and videos is not permitted under the Act. But while Council doesn't condone service stations carrying out illegal activities, it does plan to approach the Department of Environment and Planning in an effort to get the law changed in order to broaden the range of services service stations are allowed to offer. The Council believes the station should be permitted to sell what it describes as items of a refreshment nature, meaning soft drinks, confectionery, cigarettes and ice. Before applying for a change in the law, however, the council plans to discuss the matter with officials from the Service Stations Association. The council's decision did not please the many service station operators who attended last night's meeting. In particular, it angered the proprietor of the Charlestown Caltex, Mr. Dennis Smith, who feels he's been singled out.
I can't see myself going back to the service station and informing all my staff, or probably 80% of them, that they're going to lose their jobs in the next 2 months because of a council decision of confused councillors who made a decision that way.
Do you think the decision was fair, bearing in mind that what you're doing is at present illegal?
Well, no, I don't think it's fair because they should make a little bit, take a little bit more time over the situation being such a large situation where they've got more than one service station doing the illegal activities, as you call them. It's all over Australia if they want to go into it. Like video movies are in many service stations right throughout Australia.
Do you think you're being singled out by the council?
It's starting to appear that way, that they want, there's a few aldermen there that seem to be very determined to make sure that that I was made an example of.
The idea of a road linking Charlestown Road to Park Avenue is not new. The proposal, however, first attracted attention in February when residents of Katara who learned of the road plan called a protest meeting. So many people attended that meeting that they were not all able to fit into the hall. Hundreds had to listen to the meeting outside. Most of the opposition to the road stems from the fact that if built, it would cut through a large section of bushland which nearby residents do not want disturbed. There is, however, some support for the road from the residents of Madison Drive, who believe that a new road would reduce the amount of traffic passing their houses. The road will go through both the Newcastle and Lake Macquarie areas. Aldermen from both councils are meeting to weigh up the pros and cons in order to determine whether the road should go ahead. But they say there will be many meetings before a decision is reached.
While the crowd gathered for the send-off, the 600 passengers boarding the liner from Newcastle were making sure their belongings went with them. Then came the goodbyes to friends and relatives bound for Honiara, Santo, Vila, Suva and Latoka. Newcastle Police Boys Club Band entertained the large crowd until the ship cast off shortly after 8 o'clock last night. The Oriana's day visit to Newcastle was certainly more than just another ship making a port of call. It was a public occasion.
Very difficult situation at present, Ray, with the recession being what it is. We're having a difficult time trying to maintain the current level of apprenticeships that we should have in Newcastle and Hunter Valley.
Well, the metal trades did a survey. What was the result of that?
We have done a number of surveys over the last 9 months, and it's showing at the moment that the intake for this current 12-month period compared to the previous 12-month period is a 6% reduction on new apprenticeships this year within the metal trades.
60%?
60%.
Well, what does this hold for the future then?
For Australia and for this valley in particular, it means that we will not have apprentices who would eventually become tradesmen in sufficient numbers to meet the economic boom that hopefully will be here within the next 2 to 3 years.
Well, if things are bad at the moment, how does this hold then for the people who already have apprenticeships? Are they likely to lose them?
This is another major problem that we've had, which we have discussed with both federal and state government personnel. We at this moment in this valley have 300 apprentices that are not actively employed on productive work, which means really that unless the situation improves quite dramatically, their apprentice indentures could be terminated by their companies.
And they would have wasted their training already?
Unfortunately, that is correct.